Restart the conference. So, welcome again for the new attendees. These first stations aim to present the results of the project. Each partner will have the difficult task, I can say, to present their activities and achievements in 10 minutes each. But before, I just would like to remind the objectives of the Eco Waste for Food project and the way we have worked together. The project gathers six European regions, one city, and the SIAM Montpellier as coordinator. The objective was to promote each territory on each territory, the eco-innovation that could be social, economic, or organizational, that help combating food waste and losses all along the food chain. Considering that the local authorities should have a key role in such issues. The project intends to mobilize available funds from the regional operational program. We see this at the very beginning with the presentation of Anne Rocheteau, or from other strategic funding programs. It could be the case for the city of Ferrara. The second main objective was to engage a dialogue with the manager of the ERDF and other local funds to make food waste a stronger and more explicit priority in the future regional and local programs. We make a short video to present the spirit of the project and the main global results. And before the presentation of each partner, I suggest to watch this video. We just received it this morning, so I will discover it in the same time as you. So it will be a surprise for all. If I found it. I don't see it on the screen. No. Sorry, I don't see the. I will check this because I don't understand why I don't. Okay, and so. Okay. The global presentation. I don't know how you find it. We will discuss this tomorrow in our steering committee. So let us begin the presentation of the results. So we begin with Alexia. I let you present yourself, and you have 10 minutes to share with all the participants the result of your action plan. You have the floor.
Yes, thank you, Jean-Paul. My name is Alicja Nowak. I'm head of the unit of acquiring and implementation of projects in Marshall Office of the Wielkopolska region in Poznań. And I'm honored today to present the main results which we achieved within the project in the Wielkopolska region. As the beginning, I would like to present you a short clip which we made of photos which we took during the activities which were performed during implementation of our action plan. So we will start. I will share the screen. Where is it? Okay.
We can see the movie. We see your the folders. You have to launch it on your computer, and after share the documents.
Okay, but it is already playing, so I will try to restart it. Stop sharing. I will do it again. Share screen. Yeah, is it fine?
Thank you.
Yes, and it was our short presentation. As you could see, we had a lot of activities during the last 2 years when we were implementing our action plan. First of all, we had open days in which students from primary school took part. We had 13 schools and over 100 children. So they were learning not only about it, how to prevent food waste and that it can be redistributed to people in need, but also that this way we can help other people, our neighbors, our citizens. So the target group was youth and children. Taking into account youth, you could see our students of the secondary schools with gastronomy profiles. They had workshops on which they were learning how to use leftovers, how to manage the food and products which they buy in the restaurants, because they may be the future chiefs of the restaurants. And we also worked with students who elaborated and designed over 14 foodstuff test products for which they used byproducts from the agri-food industry. It was mainly the pomace from production of oil, but also from production of vegetables and fruits. So they designed new kind of crisp bread, vegetable pate, beetroot cookies, fruit mousses, etc. It was the idea to present not only the new generation of our scientists or entrepreneurs, but also for the present branch, that the efficiency of the product they use for food processing is not finished. It was already said by the Professor Ward in the beginning of the conference that we have also so-called virtual losses of our food. And we also took this point into our consideration, and we just counted on the invention and innovativeness of our students. And I think they did the good job. So we have these recipes, and it's the offer and inspiration for our small and medium-sized enterprises processing food, producing high-quality food from Wielkopolska, that they can enhance and also wider they offer by introducing new products, also with taking into account the trends of healthy food, so-called. I know that each food should be healthy, but it is used commonly in mass media that now is a trend for healthy food. So that was also that kind of inspiration. And we also produced, for example, the brochure, Kitchen Without Losses. Yes, it is full of the recipes which were invented by the students of secondary schools during these workshops at the University of Life Sciences in Poznań, as well as during the workshops in Concordia restaurants, which were managed by the chef of this restaurant, showing them how to plan properly the menu, taking into account a proper management of the food they had, and also what to do with so-called leftovers. And also that the same, for example, vegetable, we could see the cauliflower, can be used in many ways. So they have one product which offers several menu. And of course, we also this year, we would like to repeat a lot of the activities which we already implemented last year, because from our point of view, it was a great success. But due to the pandemic of the coronavirus, we just did the two huge activities. One of them, it was a competition for pupils of the secondary schools with, as before, gastronomy profile of classes. But this time they had to design and propose the leaflet on the title Plan, Do Not Waste. The purpose of the leaflet was to promote positive behaviors in the field of food and drawing attention to environmental threats resulting from bad behavior in food handling, as well as developing interest related to high quality regional food and increasing awareness of the factors influencing consumer purchasing decisions. So it was during implementation of action plan, it was our second competition, because last year it wasn't shown in this short clip, but we also had competition for students who developed three nominated clips or promoting films devoted to saving foods from being wasted. And the second action which we implemented this year was connected with the consequences of the economic and social pandemic lockdown. And the board of the Wielkopolska region, taking the resolution, decided to support transport of food redistribution from Wielkopolska groups of associations of food banks. They are located in Poznań, Konin, Pila and Leszno, to the people in need. So such people requiring food support. They were not only people who were on quarantines or isolation due to the illness COVID-19 and some hospitals, but also people who has lost their jobs due to the lockdown. So that was in short what we did in the Wielkopolska region. We plan to put as much information as possible on the project website as well as on our regional website. And I will be pleased to answer the questions if you have some. So thank you very much for attention.
Thank you, Alicja. We will see if we have time for question at the end of the presentation or for the partner, but it could be a good thing if we have some time for to be able to answer to question. So now I will give the floor to Michele. If I'm not wrong, I have to launch your video.
Okay. Yeah, it's a very short clip. Yeah. Is an interview, actually.
Now, Paul, we cannot hear anything.
You have the floor, Michele.
Okay. All right. Well, luckily I've put the subtitles in the video, so this might have helped our attendees to understand the framework in which we've worked. Now I'm going to share with you my screen. Hopefully, I basically have to do like this and then here we are. This here. Yep. You see it? Okay. Do you see it?
Yeah, we do.
All right. Okay. Thank you, Anna. So basically, okay, we start from the very beginning. Okay, as you might have, okay, as you might, yeah.
Put it in presentation format though.
Thank you. All right. So as you might have get from these from the short interview we began, we started working with EcoWiz for food in 2017. And sorry, forgot to introduce myself. My name is Michele Pancaldi and I work at the municipality of Ferrara and specifically for the Center for Education to Sustainability, which is a center run by the City Council from 1992, from the Rio Declaration. What we do is basically promote sustainability in schools and to citizens and in citizens. So I'm not going too much into details on what we did in the past 3 years because we have, honestly, I have to admit we have worked a lot with our stakeholders and our municipality. The result of this work has been an action plan which is based on three main pillars or action. We introduce new training modules in schools. We have replicate the experience of the region Catalonia with a pilot action called Mangia e Pensa, Eat and Think. And then we have introduced and developed a last minute market network. Action one, so the training modules. The action is basically the capitalization of the experience of eco waste for food within the main activity of our center. Our mission is to promote workshops and laboratories and training in schools and for free. And all this activities are basically dedicated to environmental topics, so from sustainable mobility to biodiversity and so on. Thanks to Eco Waste for Food, we began to introduce workshops in school on food waste. And we began in 2018. These are the result of the last school year. So we had basically two lab: Food for the Planet, Food Waste Reduction, Food Waste, Environment and Resource Efficiency. As you might have seen, the impact on pupils has been quite good, in my opinion. We have we've involved more than 600 pupils, and because our idea is that, as Professor Ward has mentioned, is that food waste begins at home. So if we work on pupils, they might be able to replicate what they have learned in school within their family. So there is like a multiplying effect on education. The second action is the Part Action Mangiai Pensa, and this has been extremely hard to put in place because we had to work with the schools, with the local health authority, and with the families and with pupils, but it has been extremely rewarding. And this pilot action basically takes inspiration from the good practices concerning food waste we have seen in Spain and Finland somehow. And then also we took inspiration also from some other best practices going on in our region. So Mangiai Pensa in 2018 and 2019 has involved 350 pupils, 30 teachers, because teachers have been trained to run the activities with their pupils. We began with just two pilot schools with a very small budget, just 10,000 euro. Now, honestly, Mangiai Pensa was to be proposed again in 2020 in 8 school with the aim to make it a regular activity in the school of Ferrara. And we allocated a budget of 70,000 euro. This project is still ongoing. Honestly, due to the COVID-19, we had to reframe all the activity and reschedule all this. So we might be able to do to continue this in 2021. So after the closure of the project, the idea, as I said, is to transform a Mangiai Pensa in a regular activity. Then we have the action 3, the last minute market network. The idea is to create a network of virtuous retailers and supermarket involved in the so-called last minute collection scheme. So to increase the network, to introduce new tools to facilitate the recovery of unsold items, like for example, a cargo bike, because Ferrara is a city bike and people use bicycle quite a lot. So it's a common mean of transport, to introduce new tools to facilitate the management and storage of unsold items. For example, blast chillers, which are not very common here in our city, and increase in skill. So through the introduction of procedure support manuals, sanitation, reduction in the production of organic waste, and so on. We foresee that we might be able to reduce the production of organic waste to at least 40 tons each year. Now, these activities are financed by the region Emilia-Romagna, and we were supposed to start in January 2020. We didn't due to the pandemic, but we have planned to start this activity at the end of this month. So if you're interested, we might be, we will be more than happy to keep you informed about our next activities. These are the three main pillars. I know it's very short, and if you have any question, please do not hesitate. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Michele. Now we go on with Nikos and Western Macedonia. Nikos, you have the floor.
Okay, thank you, Jean-Paul. I will start sharing my screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. So my name is Nikos Vasiliadis. I'm the technical consultant of the region of Western Macedonia. I will present to you the results of the projects the project implementation in Western Macedonia. So just a few things about the region. This is a region which has a significant primary sector. So there is a lot of agricultural activities activity in the region, also livestock farming. But this also leads to important secondary sector production activities. Due to the production of dairy products or fruit products. Also, this region is the biggest energy producer in Greece, and it's actually one of the EU's coal regions in transition. So it's going to be in a transitional phase, closing down coal facilities and trying to change to a more sustainable energy model pretty soon. And it's a region with low levels of research and development levels. So we started at a point based on this where we can see that there are opportunities. There is food waste in the region, basically due to the fact that we have important primary and secondary sector related to food and to agriculture. However, food waste was never part before the project, was never part of a policy tool, of a strategy at regional level. The only thing we could see is a few initiatives of private sector enterprises who were trying to reduce their cost to increase the efficiency of their operation. And in this manner, they tried to reduce also food waste during their processes. There was also no plan to include food waste in the policy agenda of the region, since actually at national level also there was no food waste management policy or strategy. There was not even a circular economy policy and strategy. The first circular economy national strategy was released on December 2018, and since then it has not been applied or deployed, and there are other actions right now that are undertaken at national levels. So since there was the food waste was an unknown word in the policy discussions, there were also no measurements of food waste and a very low awareness for this issue among the region of Western Macedonia stakeholders. So what did we want to achieve? Through the project, and also these are project goals as well, but also Western Macedonia goals, we wanted to increase awareness in the region about food waste. We wanted to learn from good practices applied in other areas regarding the reduction and valorization, maybe through reuse of food waste. We want to assess policy tools applied in other regions, for example, like in France, and the possibility to create similar tools for the region of Western Macedonia. We wanted to involve and include the stakeholders of Western Macedonia in the discussion about food waste and also in the exchange of experiences in food waste issues with other stakeholders from other regions. Finally, this was also a project goal. We wanted to create an action plan that defines actions to influence the targeted policy tool and create a tangible result at the end of the project. And through this action plan, we aimed at attracting interest for investments in food waste reduction and reuse at the regional level. Also, I would like to point out at this moment that there are specific characteristics of the region of Western Macedonia that limit the applicability of other good practices. For example, the other partners talked about schools and how to train kids in managing food waste in the schools. In Greece and the region of Western Macedonia, the restaurants in schools are not a usual practice. So such practices, for example, are not applicable in Western Macedonia. That's why we were focused more, we were targeting more the enterprises and producers of mainly producers of food products. So what we have achieved? First, we have identified some good practices. Shortly, I can tell you that we had two important ones. One was from the cooperative Dimitra and Velbedo, where they had high quantities of ripe fruits. And they established partnership with juice factories, which did take the ripe fruits in order not to have any food waste produced by Dimitra, by the cooperative. Also, we have identified Borume, which is a non-profit organization whose mission is to produce food waste and fight malnutrition in Greece. They have several programs like Stop Food Waste, which is about awareness, Borume at School, which is about educating kids and trying to create a multiplier effect through their education. Borume Gleaning, which is about reducing food waste on the field. Borume at the Farmers Market, which is about taking food, food residues, food that is not sold at the farmers market, and providing people in need with this kind of food, and other actually activities. So first, we identified the good practices. We identified also the stakeholders in Western Macedonia, and we involved them in the project activities through cross visits that we have participated and included visits in Finland, in England, in France, in Italy. So actual awareness has been raised through these dissemination activities. The stakeholders have started thinking about the food waste issue. In this way also, we have started discussions with the managing authority of the regional operational program of Western Macedonia, and we have managed to include the topic of food waste in the policy agenda of the region of Western Macedonia. So actually, the action plan was the basis that we have produced, was the basis for the discussions with the managing authority. These action plans included two activities which aimed at increasing the interest for investments in first in reducing food waste at the source, and second and in reusing products which are considered today to be unusable or could not be sold. We have made two attempts to integrate these kind of actions in the goals of the regional operational program and actually included in the policy instrument we have selected. The first attempt was not successful since it was more general, the topics, but in summer we managed to have some calls in Western Macedonia with the topic of food waste management, reduction and reuse included in the topics of the call. So actually, we managed in this way to attract interest for investments in food waste reduction and reuse, which interest would be even more higher if the funded percentages were higher, but this was not an option. These are limitations of the regional operational program. And we managed to include food waste in the policy topics also for the next programming period. So what happened after launching the call in summer of 2020? The biggest success for us, although it's just a single case up to date, is that we managed to attract interest for a big investment from one of the biggest companies in Western Macedonia, and actually it's one of the biggest companies in Greece, who is about to start to conduct research and development activities for the reduction of the use of food waste in their product lines. So this is a company in the food sector, and it's called Alpha and produces pastry products. So the idea that they have is to reduce the food waste from the production line and also to reuse the leftovers from the pastry products they produce in the production lines in different ways. That's why we say that they also conduct research. So in summary, what was the impact of the project on the region of Western Macedonia? First, we had the short-term impact, which concerns the impact during the project lifetime and refers to the increased interest in food waste in Western Macedonia. We managed, as I said, to include food waste in the policy agenda of the managing authority of the regional operational program of Western Macedonia. And we had created some investment opportunities through the call launched in 2020. The long-term impact would be the food waste management and reduction to become a strategic objective for enterprises in the region of Western Macedonia. Also, in the future, we would like to have the diversification of the food waste management activities and practices in Western Macedonia based also on the good practices we have seen in during the Eco Waste for Food project. And maybe to include more topics and to have more investment opportunities in the next programming period. So the next steps for the region is to retain food waste as a topic in the policy agenda, maybe not as a separate, you know, as a single topic, but maybe also in the frame of a general, more general circular economy strategy in the region. Also to expand and diversify the funding schemes by including more food waste management topics and to enhance the public-private sector cooperation in food waste. So thank you. And I will be available to answer to your questions after the end of our presentations.
Okay, thank you, Nikos. I now give the floor to Pia for the South of Slovakia.
Thank you. Share my presentation to you. So, good morning, everybody. I think it's still morning. I'm Pia Kattelus, and I worked as the Manager of International Affairs in the Regional Council of South Ostrobothnia. And I have had the pleasure of doing the second part of EcoWaste for Food project, which is this follow-up phase. So most of the hard work has been done before I have became involved in the with the project, but it's been interesting to catch up and follow what's been done and what has been developing. At first, a little info about our region. So we are here up in the very north of European Union with 5.5 million inhabitants in the whole country, of which 190,000 are in our region, live in our region in 17 municipalities. The region is quite rural. For us, Seinäjoki, our biggest city, is sort of medium-sized city when you think about Finland. For most of you, it's a small town. And the food sector in general is very important to the region from farm to fork. So we have around 18,000 SMEs in the region, and of them, at least 35% connect to food sector, industry, processing, trade, also education and RDI, of course. We don't, the regional council is a federation of municipalities. It's not a state administrative unit. And we have quite limited resources for regional funding or even ERDF funding. So that's why I'm introducing you around 11 actions from our action plans and some good practices that were not included to the action plan. But most of them are funded either by private funding or done as a part of the normal everyday work of the actors involved. And here we go. We have actively had 3 municipalities involved in the project, working with the school sector in Ilmajoki and Soini, either reducing food waste at school kitchens or selling the surplus. And then this common fridge idea of Seinäjoki City, or in Seinäjoki City, has been organized in a two hands factor, I would say. It's a unit where unemployed persons work. They are supported to work there, and they organize the flea market, run the recycling center, and they also have a lunch restaurant. And there is this fridge where you can take your surplus food. It has to be of good quality, still very edible, but something that you don't need your personally, so you can share it. And then 2 universities have been involved. Seinäjoki University of Applied Sciences very much, as you can see. They have developed curriculum for their own younger students, then continuing education course for professionals. And then there are 2 project ideas or proposals still in progress for improving interaction between different stakeholders in the food sector. And then also making beer of surplus bread. That probably will be a bit of a challenge because there is not that much surplus bread anymore. Things have developed. About wasteless project with University of Vaasa and Seam, I'll tell you a bit later, a bit more. And then we have 3 companies involved as well. Atria LTD is one of the biggest food factories in Finland. And from them, there was a good practice description of decreasing waste in their slaughterhouse. Lakeuden Etappi is a waste management company, big regional one. And they have been very active in developing different types of learning materials for schools. And Rescue Club is a nationwide company at the moment, mostly present in bigger cities or medium-sized cities. They have an application through which restaurants can provide their surplus food to be bought and consumers can buy it. One NGO has been in our regional action group and active otherwise as well. Rural Women's Advisory, they have had projects in their own related to food waste. And they have in one of those, they have developed this course, which is available for anyone who wants to buy it and organize it. And then the last one, this is also a project proposal in process because due to COVID-19 for some part, but which would involve quite many actors, also private from trade and business sector, but these listed here are more or less public, Seinäjoki City, Lutheran Church, and the hospital district. And again, university is also involved here. So that's what has been happening and developing. Wasteless project is the only one funded from EIDF and included to our action plan. And that relates very much to what Professor Ward was saying about actually reducing production of wood, food waste. And this has been implemented in school kitchens. But of course, the methods and tools they're developing are available to any kitchen interested. From the municipality point, it's first of all about money, but as we heard, there are other important, even more important implications as well when we manage to not to produce surplus. There will be a short video clip about this after my presentation. So let's move on. This was supposed to be a commercial for you to participate to this webinar next week, because Rescue Club will be introduced in that one in more detail. But I just realized that it's full booked. So sorry, you missed the opportunity unless you are registered already. I guess that's all I wanted to say at this point. And now, Jean-Paul, will you run the video, please?
Thank you, Jan. Thanks a lot for all this information, the presentation, this very fine video. Thanks a lot. Now, Jan, I think it's your turn.
So, good morning, everybody. Could you hear me? Okay. So I will share presentation. So my name is Diane Fréquelin. I work for the Regional Council of Provence-Alpes-Côte d'Azur in the south of France, and in the economy, circular economy and waste department. So we join our European partners this great adventure that is eco-waste for food. And for that, we mobilized since the beginning 10 of our regional partners, public authorities, but also industrials and associations. And we shared for the two first years good practices with all the partners, and we identified some regional good practices and shared them with all of our European partners. This time shared help us to elaborate the action plan for the region. And we have five axes developed in this action plan. The first one was the creation and the structuring a regional network to fight against food loss and waste. We work also in with high schools in the second axis. The third axis was for the communities, for local authorities we work with in our territory. The fourth axis was built for food agri-food companies, and the last one was to promote the donation. And in those axes, we develop many actions that we develop for the two last years of the program. So we have a focus on the regional network, Regalim, and I have my stakeholder. I don't know if she can speak about it right now.
Yes. Hello, everybody. I'm Julie Lombion, the coordinator of the network Regalim. It was created in October 16th, 2019, after a year and a half of pre-planning. The aim of the network is to federate regional actors across all the stages of the food supply chain: production, transformation, distribution, consumption, increase the deployment of best practices, and help create ambitious projects to fight against food loss and waste. The network is constituted of four working groups. The sum of each group were chosen through collective intelligence methods involving about 60 local actors. The SEMHA, awareness raising among the general public about food waste, quantification of food waste in catering, food donations. Besides the working groups meetings, the network produces guides and learning resources and organizes webinars in order to highlight local actions against food loss and waste. The other slide, yes. You can see on this graphic that the working groups met throughout the year and more meetings have been planned before the end of the year. Thank you.
Thank you, Julie. So I will go on and present you some results about the other axis. I just wanted to say that we are very proud of the Regalim network because it was a hard work to manage. And thanks to Julie and his team, it's on the road now. So the second axis was about high schools and catering. We work with the high schools direction in the regional council. It was a transversal work, and we elaborate some training cooking for the teams, some modules to have a responsible collective catering also, because when you're talking about food losses, you can't imagine to you have to work for all the chain, and we think that canteens preparation is beginning with all the good food and the sustainable food, and all we work about training cooking, but also with the command for the food. So we work for these 2 years with in the internal department, but also with our regional agency, the Biodiversity Regional Agency, to elaborate these training modules in our high schools. The others, three and four, five axes, is about the communities, food industry, and donation. We work about thematic and regulatory watch for communities to share information. We elaborate also a guide for communities to reduce food losses in collective catering, because high schools are under our control, but elementary school and middle school are under the control of other local authorities. But in those years, we saw the real dynamic to work on the collective catering and the importance to make programs about that. We also work with our partners for agro-industry manufacturers to to make them understand that they have their part to do in this fight about food losses. And we work with the consular chambers, with Le Crit Agro also. And this is an axis still in development because of the health context this year, who was quite rough for everybody. And also for local authorities, we work to the implementation of the collective catering donation, because if there is work with the cooking teams, sometimes we quantities are too big, and we think that donation is not also for the commercial for distribution, but also we have a work to do with this, and we have to collaborate with elementary bank, food banks, and associations for donation. So to end my presentation, what can I say about that is that Ecowaste for Food was a real dynamic for us, because it shows us how to work with this, and how this issue was important. So the region get involved since 2017 in this issue, and how important it is for us is that we integrated it, this thematic, in our climate plan. And our regional roadmap, even if something more strategic, because we are working about organic materials, we included food losses and fight against food losses in this roadmap, because it's a step, a necessary step to work about that. And our perspective now is to mention it in the new operational program of ERDF. We're working also about the state region contract plan for the same period, 2021-2027. And also we have the will to work really strongly with the local communities. And so we are working to new contract of objectives. And the question, the issue of the fight against food losses is mentioned in that new contract. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Liane and Julie. Now it's time for Emma from the Devon County Council to go on.
Thanks, Jean-Paul. I'm just going to share my screen. strange. It's not showing me the presentation. Just a minute. Okay. Okay. Right, it should be working now. Is that okay? Okay, thank you. Hi, everybody. Good morning. My name's Emma Croft. I work in the waste management team of Devon County Council in the southwest of England. But I work on waste prevention, and for the last 4 years, as part of the Eco Waste for Food project on food waste prevention. As we had quite a limited amount of time to talk, I haven't done much of an introduction to our region. I'm sorry, but we are primarily a rural county, agricultural and large tourism industry as well. Approximately 800,000 population and one small city, Exeter, and about 30 market towns across the county. So, coming to my presentation, these estimates of food waste across the supply chain in the UK, done by RAP, the Waste and Resources Action Programme, which is a charity that works internationally on resource efficiency. In the UK, the regional authorities, so county councils as Devon, have responsibility for household waste. So we don't have any jurisdiction over commercial waste or supply chain waste. But the Eco Waste for Food project gave us the opportunity to look at the bigger picture, to look in a more holistic way, which has been beneficial for us. And the projects and the action plan we came up with actually are dealing with waste and preventing waste, food waste throughout the supply chain. But there is sort of, there's citizen benefit to the work we've been doing and will be doing. Okay, so our action plan involved two main actions. These are our names for them: DIY dinner and food freedom. I'm going to go into the detail of both of those. And these will influence a review of our internal Devon-wide waste and resource management strategy that Annette Dentith will talk more about later. So as you'll see, that strategy is dated March 2013, it's currently being reviewed and updated. And again, Annette will talk a bit more about this later, but our strategy, as well as our work, our actions feeding into our strategy, the national strategy feeds into our own approach. So this is a new strategy for England with an entire chapter on food waste that was published at the end of December 2018. Okay, so what have we been doing as part of the Eco Waste for Food project? So we were lucky enough to apply for and benefit from being one of the pilot actions as part of the Eco Waste for Food project. And this action specifically was inspired by our research visit to Ferrara in Italy. So that picture top right is a kitchen session in Italy. And DIY dinner, DIY means do it yourself, basically. So the intention was, and we have run 8 cooking courses, 6 workshops in 8 locations across Devon. And the idea of the courses were to teach people to cook from scratch, so householders to cook from scratch and reduce food waste at home as they cooked. Each of these courses was led by a skilled community food worker. Okay, and we focused on key behaviours to reduce food waste at home, such as portioning and planning meals. And the course itself, the course program, was co-created in conjunction with the community food workers. And it so happened that our waste management department, Recycle Devon, had published or online published a cookbook focusing on reducing waste about the same time. So at which you can see bottom right, and I can make the link available to that. So a lot of the recipes we cooked were from that cookbook, and that's entirely focused on food waste prevention. So this is a poster for one of our courses. The courses started in January, ran through to March. We had seven courses running concurrently and one that started 2 weeks later. So, and actually the one that started 2 weeks later, the last two sessions were cut because by then the coronavirus restrictions had come in. But otherwise we essentially ran 46 sessions out of 48, 2 hour sessions, and we had 100 participants signed up. So I calculated that, you know, we had 1,000 hours essentially of tuition. So I've got a quick sort of animated slideshow, which has a bit more illustration about this, one of our courses. Going to have a go at playing this. I've got two possible ways for it to start. So, I'm going to try this. If you can't hear, the sound is only music, actually. So if the sound doesn't come through, it's not too serious. No, doesn't look like it's gonna. Normally it's okay. I hope that worked. No. Okay. I'm sorry. I'll carry on. This is, so we evaluated the courses straight after through a survey, and also 6 months later to see what the lasting effect of the courses were. And it's interesting. So I'm bringing you the qualitative analysis, really, because quantitatively, if you looked at how much food waste was actually prevented by running these courses, it's not necessarily a large amount, but it's clear that the courses had made a profound difference to the individuals taking part. So one of the, I'm just going to read this feedback. This is quoted feedback. So we buy less because we use the food we do buy more wisely and store or freeze any excess that can be used later. And then 6 months later, someone's feedback, these are all different people. I now cook from fresh and use up items in the fridge instead of throwing them away. And then I asked a specific question about what impact the coronavirus had on their household, on cooking and shopping, and how much waste they produced. And someone said the lockdown has meant a bigger, less frequent shop, which could produce more waste, but we only buy what we need and regularly clear out the shelves at home. So it was clear that the participants had really taken on board these new practices, and it was making a real difference to them at home and to how much waste they were producing. Okay, so that was our pilot action. The second project is still in development. So this is a project called Food Freedom. It's a supply chain food surplus redistribution project. It has a number of different aspects to it. We were intending to, well, we have already applied for national lottery funding, and we are through to the final round of that competitive funding process. But at the moment when we would have been finalising our submission for this, the coronavirus hit and the fund is currently paused, as the fund is instead funding emergency response projects. But it's been indicated that the fund will reopen shortly, and so we're finalising our bid to make a submission, and then this project will be up and running from next year is the intention. The project will work across the county, and the value of it will be approximately €200,000. So what the project will do, it will, similar to some, to many of the other locations we've worked with on Eco Waste Food, we're looking at encouraging gleaning, so volunteers going into the fields and harvesting produce that would be otherwise uneconomic to harvest. We're primarily establishing a network of community fridges, which Pia has also spoken about from Finland. So bottom left of this slide is one of the community fridges that already exists in Devon, in a small market town of 3,000 people. And this is literally a publicly accessible fridge and ambient larder space. And it's across the road from a supermarket. And the supermarket often has produce at the end of the day that is going to be taken off the shelves. You know, it's past its best perhaps, but it's still edible in you know, if it's vegetables, there's no official expiry date. And also local people can put food into the fridge. So if they've had a surplus, like apple, for example, apples at the moment, or, you know, vegetable from their vegetable growing, that can all be shared. So we're looking to establish 10 to 15 of those across Devon. And additionally, we're going to develop the use of a food sharing app called Olio. And we're also going to add in a small cookery element. Leading on from DIY Dinner, we want to incorporate some of the knowledge we've gained from DIY Dinner, and we'd like to teach some basic skills to local people as well. So that's pretty much it. Thank you. Yeah, I don't know if we're going to have opportunity for questions later, but it'd be great to have some feedback. Any thanks?
Many thanks, Emma. And now Miriam, at the last presentation, we cover all the territories of the project with you. You have the floor.
Okay, good morning. I'm gonna try to share my screen. Okay, here we are. Okay, so good morning to everyone. If you allow me, I would like to present the experience of Catalonia in the Eco Waste for Food and the main results, using as a metaphor the cultivation of a food product that is very representative in our region. When the FAO and Tristan Stewart put figures on the known food waste issue, Catalonia, like much of the world, was in the economic crisis of 2008. In that context, maize seeds already planted before begin to develop. At that time, we had in Catalonia the first study of quantification of food waste. as well the intensification of redistribution networks to bring food to people in need with the involvement of many agents and the implementation of the With Food platform or the start of the campaign We Are Food Ways, examples. These ongoing projects were there when the Eco Ways for Food starts. For us, Eco Ways for Food in our cultivation cycle has meant like fertilization for projects, learning new cultivation techniques, strengthening defenses to deal with pests, exchanging local seeds, or participating in a forum of farmers who love their job. In short, a set of elements that have reinforced, amplified the work that had been done before and give us a new energies to continue working in a moment when at political, economic, environmental, and social level, the fight against food waste is in the front line. Of the results of the project for Catalonia, I would like to highlight three. First of all, the creation of the strategic committee as a meeting point between stakeholders from different sectors involved in the prevention and a key governance body for the project. Here you have a picture of not this summer, but the previous summer with a large representation of the stakeholders. And this committee permits us, first of all, the identification of eco-innovation in the phase one, as well the preparation and the implementation of the action plan. They participate as well in the evaluation of the results, and all of them has been a reference for other agents interested in food waste. The second point, very important in this project, has been all the shared knowledge with other regions and cities. To participate in the project allow us to meet people with similar concerns and projects along Europe, visit new experiences and generate new ideas, and in the visit and then by email, very interesting conversations and the exchange of impressions between the other between the regions. And the third result is the action plan. Our action plan, with all this previous journey and with the direct involvement of the stakeholders, has this structure in six main challenges that we identified with the stakeholders. Six challenges in the prevention of food waste in Catalonia that then define our six action. You can see here like a very, very small resume. And we have these six axes, and some examples of actions are in knowledge. We are working in the quantification of food losses and waste in peaches, nectarines, apples, pears, and orange sector. In the awareness axis, we have been working with the schools, with general population, with professional sectors as well. We focused in the early prevention, trying to expand in the focus and acting in the initial phases so that waste does not occur. In the use of surpluses, we have a wide variety of projects in approach and size that were already needed, and now with the COVID, they are even so more important. In the governance area, we have the strategic committee of the Eco Ways for Food, but also a departmental commission of the Catalan government, sectorial tables, and other places to meet. And in the regulation area, the most important outstanding action has been the approval last March of the law on food losses and wastage prevention in Catalonia. As an example of these actions, I would like to share with you a video. Let's try it. A ver, wait a second. stop sharing. I'm not sure if the sound will work, but it's just music and Catalan. So the subtitles will have.
L'acció PESA i PENSA pretén reduir la generació de residus alimentaris als menjadors escolars i sensibilitzar sobre la problemàtica del malbaratament d'aliments. La prova pilot d'aquest projecte es va posar en marxa el gener del 2014 i a partir del segon mes i de manera sostinguda, el malbaratament d'aliments es va reduir en un 35% i la generació de residus alimentaris en un 50%. El mètode PESA i PENSA es concreta en una sèrie de passos. En primer lloc, els nens i nenes separen els residus alimentaris que no es poden menjar dels que sí es podrien haver menjat. A continuació, pesen els residus no menjables, els menjables i l'aigua no beguda sota la supervisió d'un monitor del menjador. Amb els resultats mensuals, alumnes, equip de cuina i educadors reflexionen conjuntament sobre el residu generat i proposen accions concretes per combatre el malbaratament d'aliments. El projecte PESA i PENSA ha passat a formar part del Pla d'Acció per la Prevenció del Malbaratament Alimentari a Catalunya, sorgit arrel del projecte EcoWaste for Food. Representants del PESA i PENSA han participat en visites de camp a diversos països europeus per intercanviar experiències.
Vam participar en una de les visites a Finlàndia i vam descobrir un país del que ens vam enamorar i vam poder conèixer a primera mà doncs, experiències educatives que sempre havien estat referent per nosaltres, però no les havíem vist. Però sobretot també el que ens ha portat a EcoWaste és que ens vam adonar que no estàvem sols, que hi havia una gran comunitat de gent i d'organitzacions preocupades pel malbaratament i que era fantàstica i era molt professional.
Arrel d'aquests intercanvis, el projecte PESA i PENSA ja s'ha implantat amb èxit a Itàlia. El sobtat tancament de les escoles el passat mes de març ha obligat el PESA i PENSA a adaptar-se a la situació.
El PESA i PENSA, per la part que correspon a la pressa de dades a les escoles, doncs va quedar interrompuda amb el tancament de les escoles pel confinament, però aleshores vam posar tota l'energia amb el reaprofitament segur de tots aquells aliments que van quedar penjats a molts llocs i que no es podien fer. I ho hem fet doncs, processant-los a la nostra cuina central i redistribuint-los de nou amb projectes de col·laboració amb entitats de caire social.
Fins al moment, a Catalunya hi ha més de 30 escoles implicades en el projecte i més de 4.000 alumnes hi han participat, xifra que augmenta any rere any.
Okay, okay. One moment. Okay, let's. Okay, then. Our action plan has came from 6 challenges, 6 actions, and 145 projects with a different distribution. And now, 2 years later, when we analyze project by project the results, we can say that almost 9100 of the plan are underway and 66% of the projects are advanced or completed. The average execution of the plan is this 71%. It's different for every challenge, but here you have like the result, the general result. Of course, in Catalonia as well, the COVID has had a very important impact in the action plan. In all these projects, 2/3 have been affected by the pandemic. The impact has been in all the along of the food change. At the beginning, with generation of new food losses and waste because of the sudden change of consumer patterns. But at the same time, our stakeholders reacted to this new situation and new initiatives and projects were started, like help people in need, but as well to commercialize products directly by farmers, very different projects. And as well, all the activities that were face-to-face needed to change to online format, as today we are holding this conference. Okay, then after this cycle of 4 years of EcoWaste for Food, we can say that we have obtained a very good harvest that nourishes us with healthy, tasty, and sustainable food, and with zero waste, food waste. And that at the same time will allow us to obtain new seeds to continue advancing. The challenges are still there, and the need to feed ourselves and respond to these challenges as well. What will happen in Catalonia from now on? The EcoWaste for Food leaves us a broad and representative and involved strategic committee with which we want to continue working as the main body of governance in this issue. At the same time, we have this law I mentioned before on food losses and wastage prevention that obliges the government to design a strategic plan for the prevention of food losses and waste in Catalonia. And this strategic plan will be based on the EcoWaste for Food Action Plan and all the work done these 4 years. We are working in the Waste Agency and the Catalan government in a new law as well for the prevention and management of waste and efficient use of resources in Catalonia that will transpose the European directives about food waste. So that will reinforce the other one. We are working as well in the future ERDF period, trying to put a circular economy as a global and food waste in particular in the roadmap as well. And to say that we have a lot of big challenges in front of us, but here we are with all this path done. Finally, I would like to thank all the people from the different regions and as well for the stakeholder committee in Catalonia who have participated in the project and for all this joint learning. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Miriam. Thank you to all of you, to all the partners. If you can switch on your camera, so we have a general view of everybody. Thank you. It's always a difficult exercise to present in 10 minutes activities that are very diverse and with a lot of dialogue with policy maker, with stakeholder, and so on. So thank you. I hope that this give the make people want to know more and do not hesitate to ask for more detail to the project partner. To end this morning, I would like to invite again Mr. Shane Ward to take the floor. So I try to give you the floor, Shane. It's okay. So Shane, I hope you are here. Okay. So Shane, I guess that you discovered the details of our project with this conference. And after having heard the partners speaking of their activity and the various activity they implemented, how they mobilized the stakeholder, and perhaps as a conclusion for this morning's session, could you please give us our live impressions on what you have heard and perhaps regarding the challenges you raised at the beginning of the conference?
Okay, thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to congratulate all presenters for giving a very succinct and clear presentation, each and every one of you. It's quite clear from the project that the emphasis on action, on demonstrating initiatives, was very, very much to the fore. And when you look at the various presentations given, one thing that popped out right across was education, trying to inform people as to how they could contribute, but not just inform them, but also action at a local level, etc. Everything starts in the home and it sort of builds from there. So it's the psychology of the individual. In fact, with these projects, I often think that the leadership could so come from the softer side of academia. In other words, the sociologists, the non-technical people, because there are a lot of technical solutions out there, but the way you operate those technical solutions is key. And unless people are willing to and understand, first of all, understand the problem, understand how they can contribute to addressing this challenge. And it is a real challenge. And another, one of the speakers mentioned the idea of food loss, virtual food loss. And that goes right back to the farm. So the concept of the full chain from start to finish is hugely important. But the driver of all of this at the end of the day is the citizen. It's each and every one of us. And I think that's demonstrated very well across the presentations that I saw. I think every single presentation had an aspect of that, some of them very detailed. The other thing I suppose is that you now look at this concept of global versus local, and the modern life, in order to meet the food requirements of the world, you have to have global food chains. And that brings with it a lot of problems. But that does not rule out the concept of local. But what I would look at is, it is very interesting to start local and look at global. In other words, if you can produce a produce that is in demand, at the end of the day, of course, unless the consumer wants a product, you have a problem. So you have to work within the realities of economies and social requirements. But if you can produce a product efficiently of a particular high quality at a local level, then obviously there's a local market. But there are many examples of products like that that have gone global or certainly international. And do not discount the concept of transport. You hear a lot about food miles and transporting products around the world. When you look in the total scenario, transport of food in relative terms is not that energy intensive, provided you're not flying it in. Now, a lot of product, some high value product, can come by aircraft, and then you're into a different scenario. But by and large, shipping is very efficient. And on the one hand, you have to look at that energy input and resource input. On the other, you have to look at the environmental impact of reduced output. In other words, this virtual food, the food that was never produced, that could have been produced if it were produced in a more efficient way, perhaps in another country. So never get the idea that you have to produce all of your food locally. You can produce niche foods locally. And I think there are great opportunities in rural areas for employment in niche foods. There are several niche foods in Ireland, but I think continental Europe, Italy, Spain, Greece are very well known for certain niche products, and they have an international market. So I think that's very important. But I still go back to the whole idea that the citizen, the consumer, is the driver of all of this. So it is, of course, there are technical solutions. Yes, and there are many of them out there, and they're all needed. And emphasis, of course, must be placed on those and understanding them. But the bigger influencer in all of this is the individual. And I think education, constantly looking at educating the next generation, not just the current, but the next generation, and maintaining that momentum and getting a sense of social responsibility. Because if you look at it, we're speaking, every one of us here presenting are speaking from a Western European perspective. But Western Europe is a minority globally. The majority of people do not have the resources that we have, nor do they have the same perspective. We waste a lot of food at home, and we waste that for all sorts of reasons. One, of course, is that we are rich in relative terms. And if you're rich, food in relative terms is cheap. However, if you're poor, food is expensive in relative terms. So you cannot afford to waste it. But we have this, if you call it luxury, of being able to waste food, which is a terrible thing. In fact, my grandmother used to say, it's a sin not to finish your dinner. So I grew up in an era when you basically cleaned your plate. That has disappeared. Children now, the way we rear children in terms of giving them choice, I was never given choice as a child. You got your dinner, you ate everything that was on it, and if you didn't like it, tough. But look what has happened. You ask, do you like this? Oh, I don't like it, so I won't eat it. And that may seem trivial, but it's hugely important. The other aspect, of course, is if you look in the bigger picture, it's not just the home. It is the hospitality industry, and that's a very difficult one. If you're running a hotel, it's very difficult to minimize waste because you have to meet the needs of your customers. That's a very tricky one. And again, I go back to the other thing, this Jevons effect, this idea that if you build a bioeconomy on top of the agri-food chain, you need to be very careful that you do not turn agri-food into a dual producer, a producer of food on the one hand and a producer of waste on the other. The only waste that you go into a bioeconomy from the agri-food sector is the byproducts of the sector, which in effect are unavoidable waste. That's something that's lost on society. And the danger with human behavior, and this is really a human behavior issue, the danger with human behavior, we all suffer from this, that if you feel that a product has got an alternative use, so for example, if you feel that the packaging that's used with your food comes in can be used, if it goes into the recycling bin and it produces something else, you feel happy enough to have a lot of packaging. Whereas if you felt, oh, that's going into landfill, this is bad in your mind, you will reduce the packaging. So sometimes success leads to failure in another way. So it is a complicated challenge based primarily on societal dynamics. Now, I don't know if that helps, but I am impressed with what you're doing, because what you have done really has got to the core issue. These are actually very human issues at local level. And I think you start local and you build from there. But don't confine your thinking to local. You have to accept there is global, but there are great opportunities for local to go global, or at least to expand beyond local to national and maybe international.